Hello, I'm Dr. Robert Bastian. My purpose is to discuss a family of conditions called variously contact granuloma, contact ulcer, intubation granuloma. While these kinds of lesions are not ominous, if you don't understand them as a patient or as a physician, they can cause a lot of needless worry and expense. My purpose is to address this subject purely as an educator to help you be more effective in working with your personal physician. We need to first set the stage with some background information, so let's do that first. The larynx or voice box here is in the middle of the neck right here, and from the inside you can see that the vocal fold lives inside this way. It goes front to back and it has a partner on the other side. We're going to be talking about injury that occurs back here in the back, and let me show you one example of that right here. So here you see vocal folds are in this parallel anterior posterior position, but here's a granuloma on the back of the vocal fold right there. That's our subject. Now the vocal folds separate like so for breathing, and they come together for voice making, and also when we cough or throat clear, there's a lot of collision. They bang together at the back. No sympathy needed because they're built for this. Now the anterior two-thirds of the vocal folds, let's make these the vocal folds like this. The anterior two-thirds has a lot of soft tissue. It's very flexible and lots of soft tissue. But the posterior one-third has very little tissue overlying cartilage. And I think it's that very thin layer over the back end of the vocal folds that's the key, the thinness there. Now with that background, what about this family of granulation tissue lesions? What are they? Well, they are benign tissue reactions or growths that occur in response to injury on that back end of the vocal fold. When the thin layer of soft tissue called mucosa is injured in one of several ways that I'll get to in a moment, the cartilage underneath, beneath that surface tissue, becomes exposed, and the body then goes to work to try to heal that injury. But in so doing, it sometimes seems not to know when to quit, and it keeps heaping up healing tissue that is called granulation. The result is a granuloma or proud flesh. Now, I have a patient, a farmer, who told me one time that this can happen on the shoulder of a horse that scratches itself against a fence, gets a little tiny wound, and then there's this little blob of pink tissue they call proud flesh that results. Dentists sometimes see something similar on the gums where there's an injury. Persons with tracheotomy can see it around the tracheotomy tube where the body's trying to heal, but the tube won't let it, and so it heaps up healing tissue. I even have seen them on the tongue where someone inadvertently stabs the tongue, and then that leads to a granuloma. Well, in the back end of the vocal folds, what is it that leads to the injury and the granuloma response? There are several things. One is the abrasion or the scrape that can be caused by a breathing tube during general anesthesia. Those tubes are used thousands of times every day, and normally there's a little irritation and it resolves, but on a rare and somewhat unpredictable basis, even with great anesthesia care, a little granuloma can follow. Now, what else can cause these granulomas besides breathing tubes? Well, aggressive coughing. A person may have a severe racking bronchitis during which there was a lot of very aggressive coughing, and then a couple of months later they can come in and we find a granuloma on the back end. In another group of people, we think that chronic aggressive throat clearing, that really kind of throat clearing, can be a cause. And some believe that chronic acid reflux, that is acid burbling up from the stomach into the throat at night during sleep, can be a cause. So those are the common suspects, but in some cases it doesn't seem like there is any real cause and it's just occurred. Well, what are the signs and symptoms that patients experience? Some people are virtually symptom-free, and the granuloma is found during an examination that was done for another reason. So they may go see the doctor with a sinus infection. The doctor happens to do a general exam and finds this little granuloma. other people come to the doctor and ask to be examined because they have a little sticking sensation, like a little pinprick here, kind of right there. Others still have a vague sense of discomfort that radiates to the angle of the jaw or even up to the ear. If the granuloma becomes very large, it can interfere with voice quality, though that's surprisingly infrequent. An example might be that a person says, I was sitting and reading, and after a period of time the phone rang and I pick up the phone and I go, hello, and there's just this little tiny catch and then the voice is fine. A few people have also commented that they coughed up a little tiny piece of tissue, and others have said that they've coughed up little tinges of blood. So there's a range of patient experiences. And most, though not all of the time, symptoms are somewhat minimal or vague, and they certainly are variable between people. Well, how is the condition diagnosed? Two schools of thought. The traditional thinking might be that a biopsy is necessary so that the pathologist can confirm that the abnormal tissue is in fact just granulation. I give no argument to that if there's any question at all about the diagnosis. But I typically am in a second school of thought, which says rarely do you need to biopsy these lesions. And that's because it seems to me with the current availability of extremely high resolution optics, visual criteria alone can be sufficient. Look at the amazing clarity of this kind of a diagnosis where you can see the lesion so clearly. Well, what are the criteria for visual diagnosis? It's the location in the back end of the vocal fold. It's also the bilobularity. You see the two lobes. And sometimes it's trilobed. Here's one right here that is trilobed. You see almost three different lobes right there. And when the person phonates, almost always the vocal folds come together fully because the granuloma gets out of the way above or below, or half of it's above and half of it's below. So anyway, those are the visual criteria, and when they're very strong, I don't think there's a need for biopsy. Now, what about treatment? Some people think that, again, there are two schools of thought. Some people think that you should remove it, and the concept is that you remove it not just for biopsy, but because somehow removing it will help the area to heal. Well, if you've heard what I've said so far, you can see that the problem with that thinking is that removal just recreates the wound. Remember that injury is what seems to have initiated the granuloma, and so it shouldn't surprise us that it recurs very commonly after removal, and that puts us right back where we started. And just as an example, I saw a man many years ago who actually had his granuloma removed 12 times. It would come back and they'd say, well, let's remove it again. So that's, in a nutshell, why I am with the second school of thought. Don't remove the lesion, but instead recommend supportive things and just surveil, just watch over time. You can do supportive things to try to facilitate healing, but it's going to take many months' time for that to happen, and we don't worry about that. Well, what happens while we just observe and wait for healing? The granulation tissue goes through a maturation process. Initially, it's attached on a broad base, and then as it matures, it gets bigger. And we say, good, you're making progress. It's good when it gets bigger, because while it's getting bigger, it's also typically pinching in at the base, and it becomes pedunculated, which means attached by a stalk, and it starts to flip back and forth, and then it finally spontaneously detaches, though again, it can take many months. Now, as long as symptoms are negligible to absent during that time, no worry, we just live with the little lesion and wait for healing. Well, the supportive treatments I mentioned minimize aggressive throat clearing or coughing. And if there's any question about that acid reflux problem, we may prescribe medications to neutralize or stop production of acid. Now, what if a person is highly symptomatic with a lot of voice change, for example? Well, we can remove the lesion to help them with those symptoms, but we intentionally leave a bit behind. We don't want to do a really good job and clean it completely out because we're going to re-expose the cartilage or the perichondrium. So we leave the stalk or a little bit of the base of it. Another alternative is we can inject steroid right into the granuloma in the voice laboratory, and that will tend to shrink it generally by about 2/3. And symptoms then often diminish greatly or even go away. We can also vaporize some of the granulation in the office with an office-based laser such as a thulium or pulsed KTP. Well, let's summarize what we've talked about. Granulation tissue in the posterior larynx is best thought of as exuberant healing tissue in response to injury. With modern equipment, visual criteria are often sufficient for diagnosis, and re-examination at long intervals, generally 3 to 6 months, is adequate. Supportive treatments while we wait for healing include trying to help the person reduce the cough and throat clearing, possible steroid injection, or very occasionally in the highly symptomatic person, removal, but taking care to leave the stalk or the base of the granuloma untouched. Once again, this is an informational video offered to help you work more effectively with your personal physician. Please do not consider it medical advice that is necessarily applicable to you. Thanks for listening, and I hope this helps.